So, at first, let's have a look on my concept idea of the class deamplifier. I mean, the concept is more or less exactly the same, which I have already presented during my first video about discrete class D PWM amplifiers, but I would propose to have once again another look into it. So what is happening here? So here at this point, my audio signal is injected, and then I'm having here like a DC decoupling capacitor, because as you know, my audio input signal here is like biased around the 0 volts point, which is coming inside because it's a purely AC signal. But as we don't have any symmetric power supply and everything is powered from a single rail, we have to give it a DC offset for the regulation loop. As you can see, my reference for the main operational error amplifier here at this point is biased at the VREF. And VREF is basically half the supply voltage. So if we are supplying everything with 24 volts, then we are having here like 12 volts at this point. And if you have a look then at this point, then you can see that if you have like a timing diagram, that the audio signal is having a DC offset of 12 volts at this point. So this is now my main error amplifier, let's say. The error signal is then going here to that comparator circuit. And the comparator circuit is comparing the signal against the VRAMP here. So for example, if this is now my error signal here, it is compared against that sawtooth waveform here at this point. And then the comparator is generating here the PWM signal according to the error signal and the sawtooth waveform. The PWM signal is then here going like in positive phase to logic, and this logic is generating more or less only like a positive PWM signal and one time exactly the same PWM signal but negative. So this can be also seen here, here and here. Then those PWM signals are basically amplified here through two power stages. I have here a gate driver circuitry, here also a gate driver circuitry, and two n-channel MOSFETs. And then I have this PWM signal, which is at 5 volts logic. I have now the PWM signal here at 24 volts logic at this point. So, and then basically the signal is going here through the output LC filter to the speaker, and also the opposite PWM signal is going also through this LC output filter to the speaker, and the speaker basically can see only the differential signal of both. Okay, this is now not that great, sorry, because the signal is basically purely AC signal, which the speaker is seeing. If we have a look here at this point, then we will have also the AC signal with an offset of 12 volts. And here at this point, we will have the signal, but only like a phase inverted at this point. And then the speaker is just seeing only the difference of both, and the DC offset of 12 volts basically is not seen anymore by the load. So then we are feedbacking both before the output LC filter to our differential amplifier, which is this one here. You might wonder now what this circuit here is once again. This is just to reduce a little bit the high common mode jumps, because at this point, as you were seeing, we had like the big PWM signal. And after those filters, so at this point, we will only have like here the signal with like, yeah, basically 12 volts offset, but basically the jumps of the PWM signal are not that high anymore as they were here at this point, and will give less noise basically here to the difference amplifier. The difference amplifier basically is then just amplifying the difference signal here. So here we would have like, I don't know, positive wave. Here at this point we would have like negative wave. And here at this output then we would have the difference, but only with a factor of 0.1. And also like with an offset of 12 volts, because we have set the reference here also to 12 volts. And this is just being fed once again into our error amplifier. And the overall loop gain in the end is calculated by that R1 and R2, But as we have already a gain reduction of 10 here at this point, we have to calculate basically R1 divided by 0.1, and this one's again divided by R2. Now let's have a look how I have translated this concept drawing into a real schematic for a PCB board. So here at this point, we are connecting our power supply of 24 volts. This is one time buffered by a big 680 microfarad cap. Then we are having here a voltage divider of 10K with a small buffer resistor. And this is giving me basically half the supply voltage here, basically Vs. Basically Vs by 2 here at this point. Maybe I can just draw it like this. And then we also need for our logic circuit a 5 volt supply, and therefore I just used the standalone linear dropout regulator at this point, going here through, having here 5 volts. Okay, now let's have a look on the error amplifier. My idea was to use the OPA 4197 from Texas Instruments, and this is basically a 4-channel operational amplifier. The first thing what I'm doing here is that I'm using my reference voltage, which is like very high impedance at this point because it is generated through 2K ohms resistors, that I'm basically feeding it to this point and having just a voltage follower to have then just the regulated and buffered VREF voltage. Then the module A here, this is used for my main error amplifier. The audio signal is coming here through a 3.5 millimeters check input, going here inside. And then we have already here buffered the voltage one time. And this buffered voltage is basically fed into my main error amplifier circuitry. So my main error amplifier is basically my module D here. And you can see here, this is like the error amplifier output. I have here my loop compensation circuitry, and we reached this time 0 dB point at 122 kHz with roughly a 40 degree of phase margin, but I will show you this also once again in simulation. And here's my feedback resistor coming from the differential amplifier. And what you'll see here is basically used for my differential amplifier. I'm coming here with my two PWM signals at this point, coming here, sensing it differentially, and having here the VREF voltage to have the DC offset, and this is going to be fed to this point here, basically. Okay, then let's have a look on the modulator circuit. Basically, I did it not like last time in SPICE where I had like really a comparator. This time I'm using LTC6992. This is an IC where you can fed in 0 to 1 volts amplitude analog signal, and this is translated into a 5 to 95% PWM signal. And with resistor, you can set basically the switching frequency, which I set to 500 kilohertz. And I have once again here a voltage divider of 3 to 1. And this has basically something to do with the inner loop gain. This I will also show you once again then in simulation, because I needed a loop gain of 12 basically. And yeah, together with the output stages, which are supplied by 24 volts, I basically needed then a division factor of 4 out from the error amplifier to have that loop gain of 12. This now here is my logic, because here at this point, like my PWM signal is going here inside. This is basically a dual XOR gate. With this circuit configuration, it generates me one time the negative signal, one time the positive signal here at this point. And this is in the end fed to the output stages here. For the output stages, I used an MP8040 from MPS, which is basically a full integrated half bridge with internal gate drivers, which can be supplied with 24 volts and delivering up to a, I think, plus minus 4 amps continuous and up to 8 amps maximum output current or so. And basically my two PWM signals are coming here to chamber. This I only did because I wasn't completely sure about the feedback polarity, and if the feedback polarity is the wrong way around, then I can just select another chamber option and you have it like in correct polarity then in the end. And yeah, basically here in my PWM input, the signal is coming in and here coming amplified out with 24 volts basically. And this is my output filter circuitry. Here I have a dual inductor, which was specially made for Class D amplifiers. And then I have here my output capacitors here with the connector for the speaker. And yeah, basically, once again to the 5-volt supply. This was needed here one time for the LTC6992, which is needing 5 volts, and one time here for the dual XOR gate. Now let's have a look to the output filter circuitry. Our main switching frequency is 500 kilohertz, so we basically need a filter which is mostly linear up to 20 kilohertz, but which has a lot of damping at 500 kilohertz. I will not explain this more in detail because I already did this in my first video, but now let's check quickly what the simulation result is. Let's have a look here on the output. So we are basically having like more or less a very, very flat curve up to, yeah, more or less 50, 55 kilohertz and then going down. And if you have a look here at 500 kilohertz, this must be somewhere here around this point. No, this point, we are having a damping of more or less 40 dB. Let's check also once again with a load resistor connected of 4 ohms. And you see the curve still up to 20 kilohertz. We are having just minus 600 millidB of drop. And like at 500 kilohertz, we are also still round about at minus 40 dB. Now let's have a quick look to the AC loop simulation, because loop stability is quite important for the Class D amplifier, as it is like a closed loop amplifier. So we have to guarantee that we have enough phase margin so that the output doesn't start to oscillate. Mainly this is done to determine the correct values here of R9 and C4 so that the loop will be compensated. But this time I will not explain it any more in detail how this works, because I explained already in my first video about designing Class D amplifiers, and we will now just simulate here for our prototype. The gain and the delay this time I set to 12, because 4 volts peak to peak on the output of the error amplifier will give us in sum 48 volts peak to peak output voltage, which is seen basically by the speaker load. So therefore, like 48 divided by 4 gives us a gain of 12, and our delay is approximately a half of 1 divided through the switching frequency. So at 500 kilohertz we have basically 2 microseconds period time, and therefore we need like a delay which must be simulated here for 1 microsecond. This here is just a quick workaround, because I can only simulate analog delays here with that transmission line, and this has to be like terminated correctly. And then we are going with our feedback signal here through our, let's say, amplifier, so that we have one time the inverted signal and one time the positive phase signal. Here is our differential amplifier circuitry with a gain of 0.1, and this is being feedbacked into our main error amplifier, which is this one. And this is our audio signal input with that 1 microfarad and 3.3k resistor. But for the loop stability, the audio signal doesn't care basically, so we are just putting this to ground, because like audio input signal is basically voltage source, and voltage source is like low impedant normally. So now let's have a quick look. Press run, and here at this point I have cut it here, the feedback loop between the difference amplifier and our main error amplifier, and I'm checked in here now an AC distortion signal. And if I make here now the division of the feedback voltage by the voltage which is on the feedback input pin of the error amplifier, I will have like the total open loop gain and also like the phase then. Now let's check it. Let's have a look at the 0 dB point, which is roughly approximately here, -4 mDB, and we are about around 222 kHz with a phase margin of roughly 39 degrees. And yeah, 40 degree basically is more or less okay, and our loop should be stable. Now let's come to the transient simulation. I think the most important simulation of all the ones. Let's just have a look. So this is also once again my main error amplifier with here an audio signal source, which is injecting a 10 kilohertz signal with 300 millivolts amplitude. And here I'm having basically my feedback. This is my difference amplifier. This one feeding back into my error amplifier. This one here is the LTC6992 modulator. Here also with that resistive divider of 4 for having the gain of 12 basically. And then I guess the biggest difference to the real schematic is basically the emulation of the half bridges. Because as I have showed you, I'm using the MP8040 from MPS, and there were no SPICE models available. So the most important things to simulate is one time the delay time from the PWM input to the output, and one time the slew rate. And I just looked it up in the data sheet, and I came up with a delay of 40 nanoseconds and 100 nanoseconds rise and fall time. And now we can have a look a little bit here on the signals. So here on the upper right edge, I am having here my 24 volts power supply, my 5 volts power supply at this point, and this is my reference voltage generator. So here, as you might expect, we have like, yeah, almost like 12 volts. And my reference voltage, of course, is also 12 volts because it is just buffered. And this reference voltage is also put here into the error amplifier. So also my negative point here at this is like biased at 12 volts then basically. This is my modulator circuitry. As I said, it is doing a PWM modulation of a signal which is fed in from 0 to 1 volts. And you can have a look here. So at 1.5 milliseconds, the modulation is basically starting off the input signal source. And we are having here this output signal, which is like, approximately around 0.5 volts. And this is the output which we are getting out of this device here. So with 500 kilohertz PWM frequency here. And this is then fed to our logic gates. So one logic gate here is doing directly the negative PWM. And this here is doing like positive PWM signal. And I also programmed here the delay time, rise and fall times also in this device here. And then you can see here we are getting an output of 1 volt, which is like the standard logic level in LTSPICE. And here we are getting our phase inverted PWM signal. And then of course we have to amplify it here by 24, that we are getting actually a 24 volts PWM signal. And you can also see this here and here. So you see here, now we have the delay emulate, we have the rise and fall time emulate, and the output voltages are correct from the half bridges on the output. Then we are having here like our first RC filters for like reducing the common mode bouncing, as I have explained you already. You can see it here that we are having like not those big common mode jumps anymore from the PWM. And this is basically the output of our error amplifier. So also biased around the 12 volts point here, but with an amplitude output of only 10% of the input signal. And this is then basically the output of our LC filter. Here is the load of 4 ohms connected. And now let's have a look on the differential voltage, which the speaker is seeing. And you can see we have a well amplified 10 kilohertz signal in comparison here with the input. Okay, you see it not so well because it's quite tiny, but I guess you can see it. And yeah, our startup phase, takes approximately 1.5 milliseconds, but we will also check this on the scope once again. Now let's come to the more interesting part, the amplifier PCB.
I didn't show you now how I did the layout, but in case you're interested about the layout, you can have a look on my GitHub, and there I shared all the Gerber files and the PCB production data so that you can also make it yourself in case you are interested. But now let's have a look on the PCB. So on the upper left edge, you can see this is the power input connector. Here I have my big 680 microfarad capacitor. This is my VREF generation, those two 10K resistors, also with the 1 microfarad buffering capacitor. Then here in the middle is the big operational amplifier. Here with the input buffer circuitry, then I have here my error amplifier. Here is my loop compensation. Here you can see it's the difference amplifier, here with the fast RC filtering and my input resistors. This is the decoupling capacitor for an audio input signal and also like a end-of-line 10K input impedance resistor so that the audio source is seeing a 10K to ground resistance of the input. Then here on the left side is my 5 volts regulator with input and output capacitor, my PWM modulator, the LTC6992, also with a resistor for setting the PWM frequency, here 100 nanofarad decoupling. This is my dual XOR gate for generating the positive and negative phase PWM signal. And then I can select via chamber configuration here, which PWM signal is fed into which power bridge to have the correct feedback polarity for this amplifier. And here then I have my power half bridge 1 and my power half bridge 2. This is the MPAT40. Here you can see like input decoupling, some other resistors and capacitors outside as it was proposed in the datasheet. Then I have here my dual class D inductor, which I have shown you. My output filter in here with the big 1 microfarad, this one here, and the 10 microfarad with the 2.2. For the LC filter damping, and this is my output connector. And now let's try it out with the scope. So at first, let's check the most critical thing, the power on reset. I will now switch on my power supply. And now you can see what is happening here. So on the left side, I have here connected channel 1 to the input voltage. Channel 2 and 3 are the output voltage. And here I have connected a 4 ohms load resistor. And you can clearly see that it needs like, I don't know, 200, 300 milliseconds until the regulation loop starts working correctly. And then both output pins to the speaker are actually biased at half of the input supply voltage in here. Now let's come to the next point. I have set the channel 2 and 3 now to AC coupling mode because we want to see the output signal. And I have connected now a signal generator and I will put now 1 kHz sine waveform on it. And you can clearly see the output waveform. And basically the differential signal of this is seen by the 4 ohms output load. Now I connected the scope probe 2 and 3 at the PWM output connectors of the XOR gate so that we can watch the PWM signals of the two half bridges. I will now power on the signal and have a look how the PWM behaves at the beginning. So now we are in idle mode. I don't have any signal connected. We see clearly that this half bridge is exactly 50-50% on each output, so that we basically don't have ideally any DC voltage here on the output pins. Now we'll start with a function generator applying a signal. And as soon as I turn up the volume, you can really clearly see how the PWM is modulating. As last measurement test for you, I have connected channel 2 and 3 now directly on the output of the half bridges. So this is basically the input of the inductor or the output of the half bridges as you want to see it. And also once again connect here the power supply. And now let's have a look what's happening on the output of the power stages. So we can see we have a similar PWM signal as directly out of the XOR gates, but only the amplitude is of course quite higher. So we have here 10 volts per division. This is now like 24 volts of switching. We can also check once again what is the slew rate of the signals. Yeah, and we can see that we have a rise time of approximately 17, 18 nanoseconds and a fall time of roughly 10 nanoseconds. And I can also connect once again my function generator in here. Let's start some modulating. Yeah, basically doing the same as on the output of the XOR gates here.
So we had now the first measurement results out of my small home lab, but as I want to give you another measurements about the power and the total harmonic distortion, I did those measurements not at home. I did them in the company I'm working for because they have quite better equipment than I have at home. And I want to give you now an overview of all the measurement results. So for the differential DC offset, so this is basically the DC offset voltage we can see on the speaker output. Ideally, it should be like completely zero, but in our case, we have 52 millivolts without load and 77 millivolts with load. So basically that's quite good. I mean, reference class DC amplifiers are in the area of like 10 to 15 millivolts or something like this. Our amplifier gain, our design target was 33, and we are measuring 33.5. Maximum unclipped output power is 53.14 watts at 4 ohms. And the total harmonic distortion is 6.85 at 1 watts, 3.16 at 10 watts, and 2.86 at 25 watts. Yeah, and even if it seems like the total harmonic distortion is a little bit high, let's do a listening test now over a speaker. And at least personally, I would say that the audio quality is basically like a standard hi-fi audio amplifier you might know.
Yeah, I'm sitting now here in my living room and I have built up everything to give you a listening experience on my amplifier. Here on my right side, we have a big stereo speaker. This is my amplifier module. We have a lab power supply with 24 volts. And here on my left side, I have a Zoom H4 field recorder. And I used this several times also for recording on live sound and stuff like this. And I think those microphones are having a really, really good audio quality. And this should be also sufficient to give you a first listening experience here on my amplifier, how it sounds like. Basically, the amplifier is already powered and you can hear that the noise floor of the amplifier is already quite low, so that you almost hear nothing. I mean, I can take this device here. You hear it maybe a little bit if I go to the tweeter here. But in general, the amplifier has already a quite low noise floor. And now let's play some music through it.
Thanks for watching this video. I hope you liked it, and I hope you also learned a lot about how Class D amplifiers, at least the PWM based ones, are working. And I don't want to promise that much, but my plan for the next videos is that I will make once again a video like this, but this time not a PWM based amplifier. I want to make next time a video on a self-resonant Class D amplifier. So let's see, and see you next time.